I'm a cybersecurity professional. I work in this industry for around 10 years. I started in the Ministry of Defense, then with CERTRO. And I hope you all heard about CERTRO, it's the Romanian Nations Response Team. It's a public institution, you can find interesting things there. I also learned a lot from there. Yesterday, we heard about speakers talking about the report that CERTRO is publishing. So I was honored to work that report. Okay, for today I will tackle, I hope, a more practical topic, which is about the Security Operations Center. I think that more and more companies want to build, to use, and I think it's a good thing to have something like that. I will try to discuss with you, because the rule would be to interrupt me whenever you think you have a question or have a comment, so not necessarily at the end of the presentation. So we will discuss about Security Operations Center, and I will concentrate on things that usually makes this objective not to be a success, let's say. So, why most of the SOC projects fail? Okay, about me, I already told you a few things. I studied around here with Nava Julia in the military high school. These are my my contacts, LinkedIn basically. Twitter is just there because I'm not using many, and also I just use it for my security feeds, and I encourage you to do it also. You can follow up a lot of CISET security companies and so on. It's very good for that. So feel free to contact me, to ping me now or after the presentation on the coming days, because I think this is the main game we have in this type of let's say activities, conferences, workshops. We can exchange ideas, we can stay in contact, so good. So why did I choose to speak about this? The actual problem is that even though a lot of companies are building a SOC, it seems that the level of happiness, of the manager happiness with the SOC success is not very high. So there are many reports you can find on the internet and so on, researchers, questioners and so on. I started just two statistics. So it seems that less than half of the companies think that their SOC is highly effective. Actually 40%, and it's also near half of them have a good confidence in what's happening in their SOC. So, for example, they do not think their SOC is capable to see new things and to be on top of what's happening in the cyber force. And of course, this is something that we need to tackle as security professionals, even though maybe you are at the beginning of your journey in the cybersecurity. I am sure that in your career you will get in touch with the SOC, maybe you will work in the SOC, maybe you will work with the SOC in your company, and so on. And when I say a SOC, a Security Operations Center can be also just a team that's not called a SOC, it's a team of incident response, of cybersecurity defenders, a CERT, call it what you want. So, I also try to express some of the complaints of the managers about their SOC. So, this is just a few of them. So, they say, for example, the SOC operates as tends to operate as a single or as a separate entity. And I also agree with this statement. But I would say this is part of the fault for this is also because of the manager's approach. Because they usually try to buy security by building a SOC, so they throw in money to build a SOC, to hire some people, and to forget about the problem. And in this way, this structure is not very connected with the rest of the organization. Usually, these people are seen as the security cops of the company. They just reach us when we try to install something and it's not okay policy-wise. And they contact us only when we do something wrong in the structure, in the network, and so on. So, because we are talking about what to improve and what are the reasons for failure, this is one of the reasons. So I use their complaints to also show what are the problems there. So one thing that should be done different is with this interconnection of the SOC with other organization structures. Okay. With the IT, for example, there is a big gap usually between the SOC and the IT. And the SOC depends a lot on the IT guys to deploy the tools, for example, endpoint protection, to deploy and manage other tools like SIEM and so on. Or, of course, you can do it in the SOC, but I would say it's a best practice. Still need to cooperate well with the IT guys. Okay. Then, the SOC throw things on the wall. Okay, yeah, the SOC, after it starts to operate, we see a lot of things happening in the network, and then we try to reach somebody. You know, we have a lot of, I don't know, scan attempts, we have malware infections, we have a lot of things that are not good for our infrastructure, and they need to reach someone. And of course, the managers don't want to be bothered with this, not the problem. They only solve the problem. They build the SOC and they have people. Okay? Good. The analysts are pretty much on their own. Can be true, because not everything depends on them. When they do, for example, incident response based on a threat they detected. Okay, this one we don't see any value beyond the monitoring. Could be true if the SOC, again, is not well connected and doesn't have control over the infrastructure. In this case, they will only stay there, they will monitor things like different logs popping up on their SIEM platform, for example, but cannot do anything. Of course, we are sold amazing, that's true, because, yeah, again, when you have the objective to build a SOC, a lot of vendors will come to you, offer their solutions, they will say that this will solve your problem, and so on. Everybody agrees with this objective that is something we need to do, and it will solve all our problems, but yeah, it's not like that. I mean, you have to do it and to build it constantly and improve. And of course, you need people with expertise, because I saw a lot of SOC that starts with two analysts, and usually they are juniors. I don't say that they don't have skills, they can have a lot of skills, but it's not enough. They cannot cover the processes behind the SOC. The management part, and so on. They need more than that. When you start to build a SOC, you need IT, you need solutions. There are many pillars that you need to cover. It's not enough just to hire 2 people, or 3 people, or 6 to have a 20%. Good. This will be the pillars of the SOC. In short, so we need people, we need technology, and more important, because we can buy people and technology, you need a process. Maybe that's the most important thing that you need to address when you build a SOC. To have in mind the clear process of your SOC and what to do. Coming back to the human resource you need, by the book, it's split between multiple levels. Okay, usually three. These are the most used. Layer 1, 2, and 3. Okay, in the level 1, you have people in the monitoring, they see all the logs, all the alerts, all the information that's coming to your SOC. For example, if you have Splunk or Elasticsearch or anything else that's collecting everything in the SIEM, you need people that will stay on, let's say, with iron glass to see everything what's happening, and they will do a first filter of this. Okay. They will isolate interesting things, what they consider to be a threat or something malicious, to the level 2. And you see the level of expertise will increase. They will do some investigations, usually more complex ones. And then there is also, at least in theory, a higher tree with more advanced investigations. And you can do threat hunting, for example, forensics and so on. Malware reverse engineering, maybe not in all the cases, but in theory you can need to do also that. With threat hunting, we mean that to try to find things that cannot be seen with your tools. Okay? You need to start thinking about use cases, ways in which you can be attacked, and put this information together to detect something malicious in your data. Because maybe you have data, but you need to know what to search for. Maybe you know that what, and I will give you a silly example, what ports you have opened, and you know for what you use that ports. You will start to search for connections to that ports, for example, to see what's happening there. Okay. And I said that the process is very important, and also the technology. Here, it's just an example of what is a SOC workflow. For each of these processes and steps, you need relevant technologies and people. Okay. And here, we'll try to see what problems you might face. First of all, we need to collect a lot of data. Okay. I would say in a SOC, you need to collect not only security, direct security related data, like things from the firewall logs. Of course, you need to collect that. But I would say you need to collect also logs from the physical security solutions. You need to know which people and when they entered into the data center. Because you might correlate certain situations, who entered in our building, who entered in our, I don't know, specific room, things like that. Good. Collecting, and this is the first problem, and I saw a lot of companies that struggle with this very first objective, because it's not easy to collect everything in a reliable manner, and of course, to have an efficient way to inspect everything that you collect. I know that there are a lot of products that promise to make your work easier, and it's true, but it's still a lot of work to reach this. Okay. And in the end, I think the biggest problem is that it's not really we don't have a really standardization in cybersecurity. You'll see a lot of logs formats, information formats, and so on. And of course, you need to do a lot of work to buy security solutions just to translate from different formats to a single format that you understand and you can work with. That's the first problem you need to resolve. Because the logs of your switch are not aligned with your logs from firewall, from web application firewall, or from other different things. And I know that from a programmer's perspective, you might say that it's easier to make some easy scripts or things that translate everything. Could be, but in reality, it's not that. Okay. You need to inspect everything that you collect, and this is even harder because you need to also analyze and correlate things, investigate, and in the end, you just want a screen with just 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe, let's say, maximum 10 problems that you have in this moment in your infrastructure. Otherwise, it's hard to work with your software. Good. Here I will talk about what we need to look for when we build a SOC, just to make sure that we are effective. So, first of all, it's the visibility. You need really to be able to see everything that's happening. And when I say to see, it's not about being able to collect everything. Because if you, okay, you collect everything, but you don't see. You collect, I don't know, millions of rows, logs and so on. So that doesn't mean that you see, you just collect it. Okay. So, and it's not only for the SOC, when you build your cybersecurity program, you need visibility. When somebody tries to sell you a tool for GDPR, for NIST directly, or for your security, because nowadays people tend to buy things for logs, not for their security. But, anyways, when you build that, you need to see if that tool gives you really visibility. Because if you go now in a random company and you say to the admin of the network, I want to see who sent this week a specific thing to somebody else, or an email, or who extracted, for example, some documents from the network. There are a lot of organizations that cannot find the answer for that. Because they don't have visibility, they cannot see who used USB drive to extract it. They don't have the tools in place. Okay, tools integration is also very important because statistics say that big companies tend to have tens of cybersecurity solutions in place. Tens. Third, fourth. You need at least 40 people to be subject matter on every tool, and then to know security and to manage that information and so on. And I don't think it's the case. Nobody will have so many people just for maintaining their tools. So, tools need to be integrated. When you buy a new cybersecurity solution, you need to look in your tools that you already have to see what integration options they have, what APIs, if the new tool will integrate easy or not, what will be the cost, and so on. Because if you just add a new monitor to your SOC with another tool, it will not be very efficient. Data normalization and correlation, again, I think that's the number one problem. Because normalization, of course, maybe you can do in the end. But correlation is just a thing that every vendor will say they do very well, but my opinion is that it's not so efficient. So in the end, you end up doing your own correlation rules, which is not very efficient. And artificial intelligence, it's still just a marketing thing. I don't think there is an AI that just you just power the button and he starts analyzing your big data and come up with, I don't know, 10 things that you need to take later. No, there's no such thing. Very important is to have outputs for the for your analysts in the SOC, not because they do not know what to do, they do know to do their jobs, but they have to be to be efficient, they have to know what to do and what to do in the whole organization, who need to contact for specific things, what are the priorities for different types of incidents. So you'll have a number for phishing. I mean, the list of activities that you need to do when you have this kind of incident for malware, other one, and so on. Of course, they need to be updated constantly. And very important that I do not see it right now in the SOC, it's a real control. Okay, let's say you have an alert from endpoint protection or from web application firewall or from firewall. But what can you do? How much time would you need to take an action in your infrastructure? Would you go from Bucharest to Cluj to shut down the computer that's infected? Will you call the admin from Cluj that maybe is not at work? So when I say control, you need in the SOC tools that they can use remotely and with right click, for example, to take certain actions when something pops up in the screen. Okay? Maybe they should shut down a station or a server, restart it, take a snapshot of memory maybe, or collect certain artifacts from that endpoint and so on. So you need control over your infrastructure. Without that, if you're a big company and you have infrastructure spread in different locations, it's very hard to be efficient. That's another thing. You need to be able to do incident response in the SOC easily with your mouse. Okay. And this is always overlooked in my opinion. Okay. Because I said that standardization is a problem, I just remember now that there is a good initiative right now, which is about to be standardized. It's called STICS, Structured Threat Information Exchange, I think is the right thing. This is something that started as a standard in the US, in the Homeland Security Department. They started STICS. This is used right now by many big companies to exchange information automatically between them, but also as a way to represent information in a visual manner. Like the detectives in the movies, they have the schemes, the tree with suspects and so on, with correlation between them, things like that. So if you search on the internet, you will find how you can represent a certain attack or an APT with sticks. And they have visual diagrams and so on. And if you put all your information in sticks format in a database, you can have easily visualizations between correlation between the data. You'll see different correlations between actors, ways of attacking IPs, domains. You will see that one attack involves one IP that is involved in another attack, and so on. You start to make correlations. These kind of things are very useful, and they started to be used well. Okay. Maybe if I want to show you a picture that covers everything I wanted to say, would be this one. So what to avoid, I think you need to avoid this when you build a SOC. And of course it might be silly, but it's not easy to not to do that. Because the easiest thing when you buy something new is to add another monitor in your SOC with a cable to that solution and say, look, we have another monitoring solution, please take care of that. Make sure that you use it and so on. I saw a lot of SOC like this one. Good. Let's see if we have any questions for me. Any opinions or examples, things that we can use to talk a little bit about that. Please.
So it's a known fact that in the SOC environment, the false positives are the main concern. So since you're flooded with alerts, how can you make a distinction between a false positive and a true positive in a adrenaline environment and very fast and with a good decision at the end?
What can be done, if you, of course, you start to filter the false positives, you learn about them, and you try to eliminate false positive next time, automatically. So, for example, you teach your solution, your SIEM or whatever you use to draw alerts, to exclude this type of information. So this type of logs, you know that with this characteristic is false positive. If I have this IP, which I know it's from my test environment, for example, I will exclude it from my display. This is the easiest thing you can do. But of course, it takes time. And you need to build it. You need to exclude things in time until you will have only the things that are important. But this comes with a risk. Because you exclude things by default, and after 6 months, that thing maybe started to be important for you, but you have it excluded already. So, in theory, you can do that, to filter, to learn from false positives and to exclude them next time. This is what's happening. Security operations centers. I will also display my contacts for the next time. Anybody else? Come on, you can ask me anything else. No, just the op. I don't think he has a question actually. You have one?
Yes. I'm too busy because everything is
okay. I try not to make suggestions on tools, but on open source side, yeah, why not? The obvious one, because you need a SIEM solution in your SOC. Well, the obvious one would be Elasticsearch with Kibana and everything. But you saw the presentation from Cyber yesterday, from Catalin. You have to build it. I mean, it's not a turnkey solution. Yeah. I mean, and this is the case with open source in general. But I would say it's the case also with the commercial ones. They will promise you a lot of things, but they still need to find you. Yeah. But you can build a SOC with open source. or at least I wouldn't exclude open source by default in any other area. In the SOC, for example, I wouldn't exclude to use some open source solutions. And I wouldn't exclude also the commercial solutions. It depends on your use case, how big is your company, how much you have spent, how many people are there. For Elasticsearch, for example, you need some engineers to maintain it. If you go into clustering and things like that, I'm not the best expert in this area of Elasticsearch, but I have commanders that know that it's to maintain it. I mean, now I have this changing a lot, the versions. Things are not compatible between them. We build some add-ons and now they make an update to the core of the product. Work again, add-ons and so on. But yeah, if you are interested in a tool for other things, there are a lot of tools for incident response for different other areas. Some of them I think are the standard. Yes. Okay, that was my presentation. Thank you very much. I hope you can hear your comments. Thank you.